just got to try out the Orion HD a few weeks ago, and very impressed with this unit. One thing first is the connectivity. It has two ports for Pro Tools HDX to connect HD or native cards directly to this through Digilink. It has optical MADI. It has ADAT, it has 32 and 32 out of analog. So it's pretty, and plus internally it has a routing matrix, a digital patch bay that you can pretty much route any input to any output to any effect, and save it as presets. The effects internally have very low latency, so you can actually record through this device by patching an effect between effect EQ or compressor like that between the output of the A to D and the output to the workstation, the Pro Tools interface or whatever interface. It also has USB 3 interface. It gives you all channels, and anything can be patched to anything. So the first thing I tried out, and I wanted to try out some of their FPGA plugins, and especially because they are the only manufacturer who makes a plugin of one of my favorite pieces of outboard gear ever, and that's the Lang PEQ2 equalizer from the 60s. You know, this was made even before I started in this business. So I have a few, I have this mix, and I have a few different plugins to show you, a few different chains I made for Antelope for presets that should be available. I'm going to load up my first one here. Okay, so this is a stereo bus insert. The first plugin is an SSL E-Series EQ, which I think they've emulated very well. I'm using that to give a little more presence in the mid-range and a very slight, about a 1 dB shelf, starting at about 4K for presence. The Lang EQ is great for thickening the bottom end, and they've really nailed that. And also, the top end air of this EQ is—it's always been my favorite. I don't know if it's the shape of the curve, it's how this EQ responds, but they really nailed this EQ. So, anyways, this is one of the stereo bus inserts. I'll play this for you and give you a little more volume. You can check it out. I'll take this in and out of the insert too. So also on this chain of plugins here, I have this Gyrotech, this Giraffe EQ, which is an emulation of a variable mu EQ. It's very nice and smooth. I'm just using it for general compression. So this is one of the bus inserts I have. Another one I made is a little more aggressive sounding. And this one consists of the same SSL equalizer, slightly lower frequency on the mid boost, and slightly, pretty much the same on the high end boost, maybe a little higher quarter frequency. A little bit of low-end filter, you know, below 20 hertz. And I'm using the emulation of the tube 176 compressor. A little faster, a little more aggressive than the giraffe compressor. And then the Lang after it, again, to get some of the low bottom end and some air on top. This time at 10K rather than 15 to get dig in there and get a little more aggressive sounding. So that this is this plugin or this chain.
Never got a chance to dip so far inside your mind, but I know you believe me. I never got the chance to do the things I really like, instead you always tease me. I'm thinking all the time I used to want to be with you, but now the things are changing. Somehow you can make me red and then you make me blue. You see what I've been facing.
Okay, this is similar to the last one, except I have an equalizer pre the compressor. Let me get that back up there. With cutting the bottom end below 100 hertz, 6 dB shelf, then the tube 176, and then another equalizer doing the reciprocal curve. Trying to achieve the same thing as a high pass filter in a side chain, so the compressor is not reacting as much to the kick and bass. So let's see.
Never got the chance to do the things I really like, and said you always tease me. I'm thinking all the time I used to want to be with you, but now the things are changing. Somehow you can make me red and then you make me blue. You see what I've been facing.
So you can see these plugins really have no harshness. They're really nice, bright, round bottom end. Compressors respond really well. And let's see, also, I have one I made for lead vocal processing. Now see, I loaded that into this slot here. See, there's 16 plugin inserts, and you can, or 8 stereo, so you can link them for stereo this way. So on this one, which I'm using on the lead vocal, let's get back to here. Using a Studer equalizer, I really like this on vocals. I used to use the old Studer console I used to have at Lighthouse Studios back in the 90s. And I've always loved that, and they actually did a nice emulation of that in here. I'm using one of their standard equalizers here to boost the top end over 5K, 10 dB, before this DBX compressor, and then another equalizer cutting it back. So that's making this compressor into a compressor and de-esser by boosting the high end into it, so it's more sensitive to anything above 5K, then cutting it back symmetrically on the way back.
Somehow you can make me blue. You see what I've been facing.
dip so far inside your mind. But I know you believe me. I never got the chance to do the things I really like. Instead, you always tease me. I'm thinking all the time I used to want to be with you. But now the things are changing. Somehow you can make me better than you make me blue. You see what I've been facing.
That's pretty much all the presets I've made so far, but there's quite a few more plugins, and I haven't had this device that long, so I haven't really had a chance to really work with a lot of them. There's a 1176 model in there. There's models of the BAE Neve EQs. We can put some of that stuff up and see how it sounds, since I have a bunch of inserts set up. As I say, I haven't really used a lot of these before, but let's see if we can find something interesting on them. Trying to figure out a way to do the old four-button trick with this. Well, is that in there yet?
Yeah.
Okay. But anyways, still nice 1176. As you can see, all these plugins sound really good. So coming into this chain of plugins through the Studer EQ, and that's actually the EQ for the vocal. And then this equalizer here is just boosting the top end before this compressor. And then this one's cutting the top end symmetrically with that after the compressor. So you'll basically make the compressor more sensitive, lower threshold to top end. So it operates as a de-esser at the same time as operating as a compressor. These plugins are sort of in their infancy now, so I mean, I'm expecting to see where there's filters on the side chain, like a high pass filter to do what I did in this chain here, where we cut the low end going into the compressor, boosted it coming out. Could do the same thing if the compressor had a filter in its sidechain. So it'd be nice for these compressors to have a high pass, a variable high pass filter in their sidechain. It would be nice if they also had a high boost in their sidechain so they could operate as de-essers and a mix control so the plugins can do parallel compression, mixing between the live and the, or between the processed and the unprocessed signal. And I'm sure all that's in the works. Right now, even as these plugins stand, I think they're some of the nicest sounding things I've ever heard. I use so many different brands of plugins, and especially on the stereo bus, I'm really liking these. This thing hasn't left the stereo bus of my system at home since I got it. I've had Antelope clocks since 1995 when it was Aardvark. The Aardsync.
Yeah.
That wasn't stereo.
The one thing I want to say about this this Orion HD for use in pro studios with analog consoles, this has an output headroom of plus 24 rather than all the other devices that have plus 20. So if you're interfacing it with an SSL or a Neve whose operating level is 0 equals plus 4, you still have 20 dB headroom with this. Yeah, I mean, one thing, and I mean, I don't understand the programming that goes into it. I've never really done FPGA programming, but because from what I understand, it's more of an emulation of the circuit than modeling the transfer function of a device. And to me, a lot of these plugins do sound more real analog than most other plugins. I mean, I use every plugin. Everything really has its place. And, you know, I'd say every company I use makes really great plugins, but especially for the stereo bus, what's in here is, I think, the best, at least for my taste.
Cool. One more question, if you don't mind. When you're recording through and you want to use some of the plugins, are you monitoring through the inserts you're making now, or do you monitor through the other application?
Well, if you're recording through these plugins, what you would do is connect the in the router in there, in the routing, you'd connect the A to D converter output to the input of the effect, and then the effect the output of the effect into the record, and you know, going back to the record input of your DAW, so the effect is now between the converter, and the DAW.
So, and that's being monitored, right?
Or yeah, of course, because it's being recorded and be monitored.
But it's being recorded too.
Yeah, if you patch it like that.
Right.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks.
Yeah, or you could patch it on the output too. So you know, and then it wouldn't be. Would just be monitored, or on as I'm doing it now on the insert, so it's part of the mix. Yeah. I'm sending it back and forth. What I'm doing is I just have
an insert,
the Pro Tools insert. Yeah, I'm just using it as insert on Pro Tools. I'm using the first few channels as a couple for monitoring, right. and then after that, the input and output is patched to the internal effects. You do all that through this routing matrix here. See, on the first few, you see they're being fed from 9, 10, 11, and 12, and then they're going back to 9, 10, 11, and 12. So anything that's patched to those, anything that's inserted to those I/O paths will go to those effects. It's just all through the Pro Tools HD interface. You could also do it through MADI. You could do it through USB. You could do it through this can connect MADI, USB, ADAT, or Pro Tools HDX, and also you can patch anything to anything. So if you're running Pro Tools HDX, and say you want to patch out to a device that uses ADAT digital, you can do that on the patch bay too. Of course, you can patch to the A to D, D to A converters. It's pretty much a Swiss Army knife of interfaces.
Never got a chance to dip so far inside your mind, but I know you'll believe me. I never got the chance to do the things I really like. Instead, you always tease me. I'm thinking all the time I used to want to be with you. But now that things are changing, somehow you can make me red and then you make me blue. You see what I've been facing.
Yes, see what's happening here. This chain is giving more presence on the vocal because of this equalizer and this compressor, and because of this in this, it's as it's getting brighter, it's not getting more sibilant. A de-esser, if it was just a de-esser, there wouldn't be any compression. Just at the top end. What this is doing is it's a compressor, but using the EQ like this before and after it, it's making the compressor more sensitive to the top end. So it's compressing the top end more. So it's operating as a de-esser and a compressor.
Right. So in this case, you wouldn't need to
use it. Right. And also, they put sidechain controls right in the compressor. A high boost into the detector would do the same thing. So there would just be one. You wouldn't need three different units in the stack to do it. If you're monitoring through Pro Tools, right. you have the latency of that. If you're staying within this unit, your latency is lower going through from the converter to the effect, and then into Pro Tools. Then,
so monitoring directly.
If you're recording the effect,
right.
You have very low latency. If you want to monitor the effect with low latency, I guess you could probably put it in the insert of the channel in Pro Tools. It'd probably have a little more latency that way. If you're just monitoring it rather than recording it, but I don't think it would create a problem really.
Like that 1073 plugin you had earlier. If I
want
to print that, I can put that on a bus and then print that.
Yeah, you would you would just put it between the put this up here. So if you
came late too. I'm sorry if you already went over this.
No, I didn't. So what you would do is you see from HDX HDX play. From line in. That's your converter. Mm-hmm. You would patch that to AFX in. So like suppose you're using converter channel 10 for whatever instrument you're recording. So you could take channel 10, mm-hmm. the line input, and take it to say I'm going to use an unused one. See AFX in. Let's say 16. And see 10 is down there now, and then you can take AFX out 16 and go into HDX record. See, so now what you've done is coming out of the A to D to converter, mm-hmm. into effect 16, which you'd go effects, and then you'd go over to 16, and then you'd put how did I get that? Yeah, and then you'd insert whatever you want in there. So whatever's going through that A to D channel is going to go through that effect and then go to your
then goes to the DAW.
Yeah,
and that thus it's printed.
Yeah.
How many effects can you do at once? So there are 32 ends on that, right?
As far as effects, there's 16 mono or 8 stereo or any combination. See, there's 16 effects channels, and you can stereo link them. And in each channel, you can insert, add new effect. Mm-hmm. You can add, you could just chain them. I think there's some limitation of how many you can put in. I'm not sure how much it is. I think as far as SSL equalizers, I think what is 24. It depends on EQs. It depends how many bands there are. Ones like the Lang that are fairly simple, mm-hmm. don't have a lot of bands. You can use tons of them. More complex, more EQs with more band or less. Compressors and EQs, I think, are either in separate memory or a separate FPGA. I'm not sure which, but however many equalizers you use doesn't take away from how many compressors you can use, or vice versa.
And these are all processed on the unit.
Yeah, this is all internal to this.
And just clarification on the output, MADI and the analog out, are they mirrored? Or are they independent of each other? Or can they be a combination of both? Or?
The outputs, I think, are all mirrored. You can take a look. I'm like 90% sure they
and
are.
And is the MADI and AES and analog?
There's no AES on this unit. Okay. The Goliath HD has AES also. See, so the outputs are whatever is assigned to a channel, I think, is going to anything that can output that, unless you patch around it separately to one output.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Okay, we're going to take one question from YouTube. Hang on 1 second. I'm going to be right back over. Start with the first one. Okay, this is from Luis or Luis Martinez.
Oh, so it's not a Russian dash cam channel?
No, apparently it's not Russian. It's sad, sort of. Do you need to use an Avid HDX card, or can you use the Avid native card?
You can use the Avid native card. That's what's in the system right now. This little rack has one native card and one UAD octo card for their plugins on it.
Lewis also has a question.
Even if you're using Pro Tools, you don't need their cards. You can use run USB to it. You just run US. If you have USB 3, you could just run it like that. The thing is, unless you're using the HDX Digilink, you're limited to 32 I/O on Pro Tools. They do that in the software.